first-year students. I'm Martha McCoy, a faculty member in Appalachian Sociology Department. We've designed this visual journaling activity module to give you a chance to experiment with the kind of visual journaling that Nora Krug does in Belonging, our common reading book. As you follow along this video, you'll be accomplishing several things. First, you'll get to experiment with visual journaling, which is, in its most basic sense, combining words and images on a page. And you'll have the opportunity to reflect on Krug's book itself, specifically her reckoning with her own family history connected to the Nazi Holocaust. Using the visual journaling method, you'll start just by making some marks and writing down some thoughts. You won't need any specific supplies and you don't need any artistic training. We'll ask you to reflect on Krug's book and also another issue that's important to you. And then you'll take a couple of pages to do some visual journaling that focuses on an issue connected to your specific first-year seminar course themes. If your instructor told you to just do this activity module and didn't give you any specific question or prompt to address, that's fine. You can just follow our directions and prompts all the way through. You'll make 8 visual journal pages in all. The questions or prompts for what to address on your pages are listed for you on the PDF document we made. That's also linked here under the YouTube video description. So in doing this activity, we hope you'll gain an appreciation, not just for Krug's book and her reckoning with a brutal history, but also for her method of graphical reflection and expression. Visual journaling is a method that can help you learn, reflect on, and connect various ideas you're studying as you move through your university courses and your co-curricular experiences. In Krug's book, note how in the last Things German section, she describes a really strong resin adhesive called Uhu glue. Krug writes that she uses it to fix objects that are brittle and have been glued together many times before. The visual journaling method encourages you to bring your thoughts and experiences together into dialogue, connecting them on your pages, sometimes literally with glue. You can then go back through your visual journal pages later and reflect on these to harvest even more insights. And whether it's through a visual journaling practice or in some other way, we hope you'll do this kind of connecting and reflecting all throughout your university experience. In the remaining segments of this video, you'll see exactly how to get started and also learn a bit more about the purpose and process of visual journaling.
Hi everyone, my name is Theresa Redmond and I'm a faculty member in the College of Education here at Appalachian State University. In this part of the video, we'll go ahead and set up your accordion booklet so that you can get started visual journaling with this year's Common Reading Book.
To begin visual journaling, you don't need fancy materials. You could use just a composition notebook or any kind of bound book. That could be lined paper, graph paper, or blank paper. You just need a substrate of any kind. This newspaper would do great. You could also go to the bookstore where they sell a number of journals, doodle pads, and other kinds of bound booklets, and you could purchase one if you wanted. Likewise, I was at the post office and I found these boxes that have been discarded and pulled a fold off the box. This is a piece of cardboard that came from a notebook. The pages were done and it was discarded. So here's 3 examples of discarded materials that you could use for visual journaling. Likewise, all across campus we have recycling bins. Often the paper in those bins is suitable for reuse.
So again, you don't need fancy materials. But if you are looking for a bit more guidance, the PDF that we've prepared for you includes a template for making the accordion booklet. It's simply a 1-page template with guidelines for where to fold and adhere. You can follow along with this template page by using recycled paper and just looking at the template on your phone or computer, or you can actually print it as I've done here and then use this to fold your accordion booklet. In the next part of the video, I'll show you how to fold an 8-page accordion booklet using a single sheet of recycled paper. But before I get started, let's look at an example that's already folded so you know what to expect.
Here's an example of an 8-page accordion book created with recycled paper and 1 piece of tape. You can see the zigzag shape of the book and how it folds together, creates a front cover, and then you get this accordion style folding that goes around the back and uses the back pages as well. Two total 8 pages.
So how do you make this? Let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to fold and prepare a couple of pages, but you only need one sheet of paper to make the 8-page accordion booklet. You'll see though how easy it is to simply fold and tear and then have several leaflets that you could theoretically adhere together to make multiple booklets into a larger booklet.
You get started with your recycled paper and you simply fold it in half. And if you're interested, that cardboard I mentioned earlier makes a great surface, depending on your work surface. You could really do this anywhere. You could do it outside on a beautiful day. You could start your visual journaling in the back of your car. You don't even need a desk or a studio of any kind. All right, so I folded my pages, and now, even without scissors, I can tear down the page. Now that said, there are likely scissors at desks across campus. Whether you're in Belk Library and you want to ask the reference librarian, hey, could I borrow scissors for a minute? Or if you're in the bookstore, you could probably find someone to just quickly lend you those scissors. And you can see it was one cut, didn't take much time at all. So I'm done with the cut. Now I have these pages and I'm just gonna start with the one piece of paper, but you can, as you can see, use other pages and attach those. But with just that 8x10 paper, I can now fold each section in half, and these are my leaves or leaflets of the booklet. And the goal again is to put these together in the accordion format. To do that, you need some kind of adhesive. Now that could be a glue stick where you glue down the edge of one page and then secure them together. But you might say, I don't have a glue stick. Other options include tape. And again, at any desk across campus, in the bookstore, in the student union, library, you might be able to find some tape. And it's not much. This is just about 1.5 inches of tape. And I can secure my pages together by positioning them over each other slightly and putting the tape there. But even without tape, to create that simple adhesion, you could use sticky labels off of a number of products that you probably have in your home, like the labels off of bananas. So check your food products out. A lot have labels that you can use as tape. And then again, I want to fold like an accordion. So I fold the front page over, and then with the second booklet, I'm folding it around the back. And that's where my tape is right here. I'm just gonna press that down. And then take that last page and fold it again. So here is my accordion booklet to get started with visual journaling.
Before we dig into mark making, Martha will tell you about the purpose, the value, and the process of visual journaling.
I wanted to tell you a little bit about what visual journaling is and the philosophy behind it. A visual journal is part sketchbook, part scrapbook, part to-do list, part photo album, part doodle pad. It's where you combine words and images in your own unique combinations using your own unique materials and art supplies. Although, while there's a ton of art supplies out there, and they're all, of course, really fun to experiment with, you can find everyday objects around the house or around your workplace that you could use as art supplies. Just start attending to what's around you that you can use as your visual journal. As you make marks and put down ideas and thoughts, whether those are scribbles or elaborate poems, whatever way you want to express yourself, the number one rule in a visual journal is that there's no rules. And that's the most incredibly freeing thing about it. There's nothing that you can do wrong in your visual journal. So what I really like about the visual journal is that it's radically democratizing creative practice. First, anyone can do it, even if they don't have the money for expensive supplies. You can even make journals out of old, recycled, or discarded books and just start painting on the pages of the old book pages. So it's also really democratizing in that it doesn't require that you think of yourself as an artist
or that you've had any artistic training. I work out ideas, I take notes. I find that it's much more fun to look back at my visual journal because it's so colorful than looking back at boring notes I typed into a Word document on my computer. For me, visual journaling is more raw, intuitive, and expressive. You can have angry pages or pages with political commentary. You can express existential angst or ask deep questions in the tradition of William Burroughs and Jean-Michel Basquiat or Dan Elden, or in the tradition sometimes referred to as raw art or outsider art.
Now that you have some insight into the purpose and process of visual journaling, let's go ahead and get started with some mark making using supplies that you likely already have access to.
You might have a pencil or certainly could access one across campus at any location. You might have a pen or a highlighter. These are three basic tools that you should be able to find on campus, borrow from a friend, or you might already have.
To get started with your visual journal, you just begin making marks and creating space on each of the pages for your reflective writing.
And the great advantage of using recycled paper is I already have this beautiful texture from the text that was on the page. So I could use my pen and I could kind of mimic that texture and just pull my pen along to continue the line of text. And as you can see, I'm getting this cool pattern of lines. So mark making with a pen, rather intuitive. Likewise, with the pencil, I can create marks. This time, I'm going to make slash marks in one direction and then go over them in the other direction to create a crosshatch. Crosshatching is a great tool to create a background texture. Finally, here's the highlighter. I'm going to do some marks on page two. And this time, I think I might just do dots. And again, using my highlighter to create a bunch of dots adds a visual texture to my page and is a relatively simple way of making marks. Now you might be saying, okay, pen, pencil, highlighter, that's a good start, but I really want to add some color. So I was sipping a seltzer earlier, here's my seltzer, and I added a little water to the bottom of the empty can. I also happen to have a couple markers, and you might be able to find Crayola markers around campus or borrow one from a friend. Finally, you probably have access to tin foil, whether it's in your own kitchen or perhaps from a meal that you had, you can wash it off and use that tin foil. This is a trick I learned from my real good friend who's an art teacher, and during COVID, her students didn't have a lot of supplies, so she showed them how to make watercolor paint with a marker and tin foil. So I simply take my marker and I color along the bottom of the tinfoil. I will pour a little bit of this water. And again, this is an empty can, cleaned it out. I'm gonna pour two drops. All right, so there's a little bit of the water and it actually mixes with the pigment, so I have a little paint. And then in terms of working with that color, there's a lot of things you could do. Here's a fork, again, a found material. Here's a stick, a found material. Here's the inside of a discarded tape roll, a great found material. Let's start with that. I can take the tape roll, drop it in my water with the marker pigment and pick up a little bit of that pigment. And when I've picked up enough pigment, I simply push it into my page and there's a beautiful mark with a light green hue. The fork works in a similar way. And I can put the fork in and create some lines as well. Before I do that, I just want to show you that the recycled paper is really thin. So my mark has gone through the pages. That's okay. I like that because it creates more texture. And I might even, in the style of Nora Krug, I might even create a comic in that space. I could also use that space to highlight a word that's really important as I'm engaging in reflection about how I reckon with past histories. If you're not interested in having the mark go through, that's where your cardboard or newspaper comes in really handy again. I can just slip that cardboard in between my pages to protect my pages. So let's see how this fork works with the color. I'll run some lines across the top. There you go. Again, no fancy materials. This is basically reuse of single-use items.
So flexible, intuitive mark making is the first step of visual journaling.
And once you've set that tone for the page, you can then use the other prompts provided to go in and develop the content of your visual journal. Here's a time-lapse video of me working with those basic materials I shared. Along with those materials, I did add a permanent marker, a glue stick, and a pair of scissors. But again, you can engage in visual journaling in a really minimalist way using a lot of free materials. You might notice at a couple points in the video, I cut out additional recycled paper and paste it down to thicken my pages in the accordion journal.
Ta-da! Here is a prepared visual journal ready for deep reflection and reckoning on the themes from Nora Krug's book, Belonging. I can write notes, stories, letters, poems, and more to begin adding content to my pages.